Hello, planet Earth.
Hi, honey.
Welcome to my YouTube channel. I'm Preston L. Young, wishing you warm salutations and congratulations as always. You've made your way to the Buffington Post.
You are invited.
Today it's time for another Buffington Post recap and review, this time for Buffy the Vampire Slayer Season 12, Issue number 3. It's The Reckoning, Part 3. The Reckoning. It's a little redundant, I know, but I don't name these things. So yeah, we've got three really good covers this month. We have the traditional cover by Stephanie Hans, a new cover artist on the book. It looks really nice. We've got Harth, and we've got Buffy and Spike, and I particularly like Faith here. She looks really good. I think it's one of the best covers featuring Faith that we've really ever gotten. She looks really good. She looks angry, but her hair is super pretty, which, you know, hello, Faith. We've got The Variant by Georges Genty with Carl Story and Dan Jackson on the colors. It looks really good. You know, I love the Georges Genty style. It's like classic Buffy comics from season 8. Like, love it. And we've got Malaka Frey. We've got Willow, of course, and naturally Buffy. So I really like this one as well. And our Ultra Variant cover is by Scott Fisher, whose work I'm unfamiliar with. It's more artsy. It looks more like the Angel Season 11 book covers, like the traditional covers. We've got Buffy up here with her scythe. We've got Angel being attacked by all these demons. And down here, we've got Illyria fighting against this dude who looks like Hellboy. So, the devil. And so, yeah, like, all three of these covers this month are, like, super rock'em sock'em. But, of course, before we get into this issue...
Previously on Buffy the Vampire Slayer.
Harth Frey came back from the future in order to create this happening called the Reckoning, which we know from Frey's timeline is when all of the demons are banished to hell and the Slayer line goes extinct. That's no good, so Angel, Illyria, Willow, Giles, Xander, Dawn, Buffy, Spike, and Faith, they decided to figure out what the heck was going on so they could stop Harth, who is hooked up with Wolfram and Harth, and now I'm referring to them as Wolfram and Harth, to, you know, stop the end of the world and the end of magic again. So they opened a portal through time, they went to the future, Harmony filled them in on the fact that Harth basically, you know, went back in time and he changed everything, and Willow went all dark like we saw in, Time of Your Life in Season 8, and that's how the whole, like, thing went down. And so now that they have the knowledge that Harmony gave them about how things are supposed to unravel in the future, they have gone back into the past to stop Harth, but the thing is, Harth is imbued with all of the Slayer memories, and so he remembers that Buffy went to the future in order to find out this information on him, and so it's kind of like none of it really matters because this reckoning situation is just going to unfold either way.
That's pretty much what you need to know, and so without further ado, let's jump into Buffy the Vampire Slayer Season 12. It is issue number 3, The Reckoning, Part 3, The Reckoning. Here we go.
Is it difficult or time-consuming?
The war was lost. The treaty signed. I was not cut across the line. I was not cut, though many tried. I live among you, well disguised. I had to leave my life behind. I dug some graves you'll never find. The stories told with facts and lies. I had a name, but never mind.
Never mind.
Never mind. I had to leave my life behind. The story's told with facts and lies. You own the world, so never mind. My woman's here, my children too. Their graves are safe from ghosts like you. In places deep with roots entwined, I live the life I left behind. The war was lost. The treaty signed. I was not caught across the line. I was not caught, though many tried. I live among you, well disguised.
So our issue actually opens up with Andrew. Andrew has returned to the Scoobies. He has been abroad. He's been out of the country. He's been doing things. He's been hanging out with Sam and Riley. And, you know, talking with the humans and dealing with, like, how the government is dealing with the whole magical community, etc. And basically, he's there to, like, weapon them up. But not with weapons. See, Andrew's like, oh, I brought a gun and everything. And Buffy's like, well, you know, the guns aren't really going to help us against the vampires and the demons, etc. But he has also brought them, like, the weapons that they need, which are all of these, like, comm links and stuff, so that they can all stay, you know, in communication with this big battle that's coming. And this is all happening at Willow's, like, empowerment center that Wolfram and Harth are going to be attacking, right? And so Andrew has provided them with this, like, you know, this, like, base of operations for Giles to kind of, like, run this army of slayers and witches, etc., while, you know, the army of Wolfram and Harth attacks. Andrew wants to stay and fight with the best of them, but actually, Buffy and Giles insist that he leave the fight, because if things go south, the Watchers' Council doesn't exist anymore, and Giles needs for Andrew to kind of keep the Watcher legacy alive with all of his knowledge about the Slayers and everything that he has experienced with Buffy, and, you know, somebody to tell the tale to these women going forward and, you know, help lead and guide them. And Andrew actually gets all misty and he cries over it, but that's the last we see of Andrew. He's not going to be coming back, so holla back or don't. We pick up with Xander and Dawn, and they are arguing over who should be taking care of baby Joyce. And basically, Dawn is like, you have no powers. I can open the portal if things come to, like, the worst possible, like, situation, right? And so Xander's like, yeah, but I'm the man, and I'm supposed to fight and be the strong one. And she's like, look, dude, we're in a woman empowerment center while you're talking about all this, so you sound kind of foolish. And we actually have, like, a Rosie the Riveter poster on the wall. Like, we can do it. And so they kind of bicker back and forth, but they resolve to leave baby Joyce with Xander's mother so that they can both be together if this is, you know, the end. We get Fred. Fred, like, still exists, thank God. And Angel is trying to talk to Fred and see if she's really down to go into this, like, you know, battle that will be the end of the fucking world. And Fred basically says, you know, ever since I came back from the dead, I've kind of felt directionless and like I didn't have a purpose. And I know that I might die, but I've already died. And at least this time, I'll know that I'm dying for something worthwhile. And so Angel and Fred have this cute little moment, and that's the last we see of Fred. Sorry, holler baller. And then we pick up with Faith and Willow. And basically, Willow is kind of lamenting the loss of herself, you know? She's worried that if worse comes to worse, then they're going to have to open this portal and send Buffy and all the demons into hell, and she will have to become dark, like Harmony said this whole thing played out. And she just feels like everything that she's done since the beginning of season 7 has been just a waste, and she really worries that the effect that she wanted to have on reality will not hold, and that she'll just end up being dark forever and ever until she basically, like, commits suicide by cop, right? Faith is like, dude, we are going to change the future. We're going to kick the future and fate in its balls. And they kind of have to do that now because, hello, Wolfram and Harth are approaching. So as Wolfram and Harth approach, Buffy and Spike are talking about, you know, their relationship or lack thereof and how they both kind of lament the fact that they weren't able to work it out. But Spike says exactly what I've been saying this whole time, which is that, you know what, no matter what happens and no matter what has happened between you and I, you have inspired me so much. You are, again, one hell of a woman. And Buffy and Spike, like, hug it out and they go off to, you know, fight the apocalyptic battle like they do all the time, so it'll be fine. Like I said, Wolfram and Harth is approaching, and Harth is riding the demon snake mayor's back, and Harth is saying, oh, yep, it's just like I remember, because I have all the frickin' Slayer memories, so let's go do this, because I know I'm going to win because of my Super Slayer memories. The battle begins, and Buffy's like, let's show them who was here first. Let's kick these demons' asses. And the mayor goes, actually, demons were here first, and we're gonna stay here. Bye. great big battle. Shit is going down. Fight, fight, fight. This one demon comes up to Illyria, and it's like, Illyria, this is your last chance. We know that you don't want to be going through these changes and that you're afraid of the humanity within you. And she's like, yeah, I do. But you ought to be more afraid. And she rips this motherfucker's arm off, and it's on. Battle, battle, battle. Eren and Malaka, who, by the way, had come back from the future with Buffy and crew after they went to the future, whatever, they go up against Harth, and they have this, like, moment where Malaka's like, come on, Harth, I know you know what you're doing is wrong, and Harth is like, fuck you, I'm evil, and Eren is like, fuck him, he's evil, let's kill him. More fight, more battle. We have this funny moment where Angel and Spike are kind of like finally coming to terms with the fact that, you know, they can fight well together and they might actually like each other. So Giles is back at Command Central and he's seeing and hearing all of these girls die, and he's telling Faith, like, this is not cool. I trained some of these girls, and what I'm doing right here is sitting back and watching these girls die, and it's fucking not fun. So Faith goes to Willow and she says, okay, Harmony told us that Buffy went into the Hell Dimension with all of the demons to keep them there. But she shouldn't have to. Let me do it. I did so many bad things, and you guys, and especially Buffy, stuck by me, and you forgave me, and you let me be more than I was willing to be myself. And she says, let me do this. Let me be the slayer to go through and hold all the demons back. But Willow tells her, Harmony said that she had to use all of the powers of all of the slayers and put it into Buffy with Buffy's scythe. And it is Buffy's scythe, and so Buffy is the only one. And so Faith is like, well, fuck. And since she can't take in all of this power on her own, she decides to use the power that she does have to kill the mayor who gave her all these fucking daddy issues in the first place. And so she starts slicing at him, and he starts going at her, and she's like, I'm gonna kill you, motherfucker. Battle, battle, battle. Demons are dying, but a lot of slayers and witches are dying, and it looks super bad. And so Buffy says, Giles, send the main cast all to me, because we need to rap about some stuff. Buffy decides that she is going to let things play out exactly the way that Harmony said that they would. She's going to get Dawn to open the portal into a hell dimension, and Buffy is going to go through, and she's going to stay there and make sure that the demons can't get back through. And everybody's kind of like, what? We're trying not to do that, Buffy. She explains that she created these women to have all of this power, and she's seeing them be cut down, and if she has to watch any more of them die, it's just not worth it. And she tells Giles, like, this is what I have to do. And Giles says, I am so proud of you. I never had children of my own, and I'm kind of glad that I didn't, because they would never be able to, like, measure up to you. And Buffy gets kind of, like, misty about it. And honestly, at this point in the book, it really got me emotionally, and it made me love, again, the Buffy and Giles relationship, because it's so beautiful. So Willow is going to, again, like she did at the end of season 11, use the scythe to suck the power out of all of the girls that Buffy and Willow made into slayers and put it all into Buffy so that she can be Buffy the Uber Slayer once again. And Buffy has resigned herself to this. She has decided that she is going to sacrifice herself to save these girls. And as long as they're alive and they can love and just live, then they have a chance to be happy, and, like, that's worth it to Buffy. So Willow does the spell. She and Buffy grab the scythe, and she pulls all of the Slayer power out of all of the girls and is about to put it into Buffy, right? But Harth jumps in with this super staff-a-ma-jigger, and he interrupts the spell, and something weird and wacky and magic fuckery happens. And so this staff that Harth used on the scythe while Willow was doing the spell, turns out it was the staff that the Shadow Men used to create the first Slayer. And so Harth has taken all of that Slayer power back. And he says, men gave you your power, and men are taking it back. And now what I'm going to do is I am going to use that Slayer power to let demons overrun the earth, and it'll all be mine. And Buffy's like, that's not how this was supposed to go. And that's where we end the issue. So I like that they actually did a little something with time travel that kind of negated everything from, like, what Harmony told us. At first I was thinking, did Harmony just lie to us? Did she make all of this up? Was she in cahoots with Harth this whole time? But I'm thinking, no, I don't think Harmony's smart enough to lie about all of that. I think Harth really did just take matters into his own hands, and rather than having the demons go to hell and him being like the supreme vampire in the future, I think he was like, why wait until the future? I can do it now, because, I mean, I'm immortal, so I'm just going to live into the future no matter what. So take it while you can, you know? The world is his for the taking, and he's doing it. And I swear, Harth is such a fucking fascinating character. I'm kind of down for it. I want to see where this goes. But I do like the fact that it seemed kind of inevitable that all of this was going to go down, and that time of your life was this, like, set-in-stone future. And here they're saying, no, we're going to switch it up, and it's not because of what Buffy does, but rather because of what Harth does. That's really fascinating to me. And I like the turn of it, but there's some stuff in this issue that just doesn't work for me, honestly. We only have 4 issues in this season, and the fact that Buffy is so she feels so responsible for all of these women that she created into being slayers, and the idea that, you know, Willow has this whole, like, women empowerment center is all great and grand, but the fact of the matter is we haven't spent any time with these other slayers. Like, we can't care about them. Like, we can care, but we don't know them well enough to know why we're caring about them. And so that really does bother me. It feels like it's trying to have this emotional payoff without any emotional building blocks to get us there. And that goes into what Malaka is going through with Harth. Like, she's legit crying over the fact that Harth won't stop being evil. But to me, it's like, you know that he's evil. You've tried in the past to, like, change his mind or what the heck ever, but he's always proven himself to be fucking evil and not care about you on a human level. Like, he cares about Malaka and Aaron, but only in this, like, sadistic, fucked up vampire way. And so they're trying to pay off these things that aren't earned. You can't pay for something that hasn't been earned, and that really does bother me. And I really would have liked for this to have been at least an 8-issue season because of little things like that. We're supposed to really be in the moment and have these emotional stakes, but they haven't really built them up. And so stuff like that just doesn't work for me. And, like, with Fred, we have literally, I think, 1, 2, 3, 4 panels with Fred, and we'll probably never see her again. Or maybe we will in the last issue, but, I mean, It's just like they're rushing through this so quickly, and it just doesn't seem like it's been earned, and it's really frustrating. But I will say that this is probably my favorite issue of the season so far, just because the twist at the end, the idea that that Harth used the thing that created the Slayer in the first place to undo them. It's kind of a twist on what they did in Wolves at the Gate with the scythe, and the scythe, like, sucking out all the power from different slayers. It's a twist on that, but it's a twist that makes sense in the idea of taking power specifically away from women and giving it back to men. And so now that Harth is the actual vampire slayer, you know, or I guess vampire hyphen slayer, it's so smart. And even though I wish that we had more to kind of flesh it out and give it some more weight and meat, it's pretty fucking cool. And so this is my favorite one so far, and we don't have a lot of Xander and Dawn here, but I like that they talk about the idea that Joyce can stay with Xander's mom, and hopefully they'll live so that Xander's mom doesn't, you know, raise the baby. So that's all good. I liked having Andrew back just for a moment. I was really convinced that he wouldn't come back, but I'm glad that he did, even just for the little bit that he's here. And I really do like the idea that he's been tasked with continuing the Watcher legacy for Slayers in the future, should there be any. And Faith, oh my gosh. So I was talking in the comments of, I think, last issue about the idea of maybe because everyone just assumes that people are talking about Buffy when they talk about the Slayer, that maybe Harmony's story was a bit confused. Maybe, in fact, it was Faith who went through the portal and was the one to keep all the demons at bay instead of Buffy, but everybody just assumed it was Buffy because they said it was the Slayer.
Mind if I come in?
And I like that Faith was willing to go there. She was saying, I will be the one to carry this burden because you all have carried my burden for so long. It was really lovely, and it just goes to show how much of growth Faith has gone through since we met her in Season 3. Faith really is one of my favorite characters. I think she's a beautifully written character, and I think that that everything she's gone through emotionally and psychologically and heroically, really, especially in Angel and Faith and in their series, makes a lot of sense, and it all pays off, and it's just beautiful. And I really like the idea that she can't carry that burden, even though she wants to carry that burden. Willow tells her, you can't because it's meant for Buffy. Which doesn't make a shit ton of sense, because Faith is technically the active Slayer, and again, I don't think that she should have lost her powers last year when they took all those, like, Slayer's powers and put it all into Buffy. But emotionally, it really works, and I really love this look on her face when she's told, like, it's not you, it can never be you, and she does accept that. Like, Faith is all about accepting the fact that she's not Buffy and she's not one of these other girls, but she's very much her own thing, and I love that idea. And I love when she calls the mayor, hey, daddy issues. Like, it's really good stuff. And the mayor gets some fun little lines here. I still think he's kind of unnecessary, but again, he is there specifically for Faith and her problems. And she also has this really funny thing where Buffy's like, all right, when we start doing the spell, all you girls need to run, 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 run. And Faith is like, look, I may not have my powers, but Frey's monster monkey gave me this super ray gun that I've been wanting since I was a kid, and I'm not going anywhere. I'm still going to stay here and fight. And that's what I like about Faith. She's always a fighter, even without her powers. She's willing to fight. And especially, like, after everything we've gone through, that willingness to fight when she doesn't have to, it just speaks volumes about this character. I'm really glad that we got this much Faith in this issue, and it kind of leads me to believe that we will get more just Buffy and Angel in the very final issue. And I think Angel might die, you guys. I think he really might die.
We do it because there's things worth fighting for.
We don't have a shit ton of Angel. The stuff that we have with Angel is fine. I like that he is telling Fred, you know, this is your choice, even though you and Illyria share a body, and I don't really get that. You still have a choice in this matter. You don't have to fight here. Like, Illyria will respect your choice. But again, I like that Fred is saying, fuck it, man. I've already died the one time, and at least I'll know that I'm dying for something worthwhile this time. And the stuff between Angel and Spike is funny. Like, the idea that they can, like, and respect one another is really nice, and it shows a lot of growth for those characters as well. Like, Faith is not the only one who's shown some growth. And the thing with Illyria, you know, the idea that, you know, she says, this human part of me, it does frighten me, but the fact of the matter is, I'm willing to deal with that, and it's something you can't deal with, and that gives her a real power.
Power. I have it. They don't. This bothers them.
Now, here's my thing. Remember back in Angel and Faith Season 10 when Illyria showed up with her super destructo rays that are super convenient? Where the fuck are those? Where are Illyria's super convenient super destructo rays? Because they would be a real game changer right about now, but no.
Get your ass down here!
Again, it's really frustrating when you have Illyria in any scene, because you're like, why hasn't Illyria just solved the fucking problem? It's one of those things where you have a character who's like way OP, but you still want that character around, and so they don't even make these excuses of why Illyria doesn't have her super destructo rays. They don't make any excuse for why Illyria isn't just solving all of our problems, and it's super frustrating, and I don't like it. But I really, what it comes down to is this thing with Buffy.
Buffy, fabulous superhero.
Oh, well, let's talk about Willow first. I really like that Willow is wrestling with this idea of, you know, everything I did being a waste of time. And for Willow, that's really important. Because if there's one thing that Willow doesn't want to do, it's waste time. She's always been, even when she was evil, she's always been very driven. She's always been like, we have things to do. And she's always been the one to kind of bring the group together and say, this is what's important, guys. Like, stop fighting. There are bigger things at hand. And here she is, and she's saying, there are all of these bigger things at hand, and there's so much that I tried to accomplish. And if at the end of the day, none of it mattered, then like, what's the point? And it's super depressing. And
grumble.
And I like that that's something that Willow gets to go through, honestly. But where this book really lives, where this issue really lives, is Buffy once again being willing to sacrifice her own life to save everyone around her. Buffy has died 3 times for everyone, for you, for me, for Dawn, for Xander and Willow, and for everyone. And here she is. She's like, I'll do it again. I will do it again. I will let you all live, even if it means I'm going to be stuck in hell forever. It's what we love about Buffy. And we, of course, have Bloody Buffy. You know how I love Bloody Buffy. She's super bloody in this one. And I love the idea that Buffy is this beautiful woman, but it comes at a price. Like, she has all of this blood on her, and it's not all hers. The idea, like, to me, the way that I kind of take it is this blood isn't all hers. It is the women around her who are suffering for her cause. And what it all comes down to is the book is called Buffy the Vampire Slayer. This is her story. This is her cause. This is her fight to fight. Like what I was talking about with Faith and her not being able to take the fight up, like being able to take the responsibility off of Buffy. The responsibility always falls to Buffy. And Buffy as a character has come so far, and she never really gets away from the fact that this is her life, this is her responsibility, and this is her fight. And she's so admirable. And at the end, when she's like, well, this isn't how things were supposed to go, it's like, well, yeah, Buffy, like, things never really go the way that you think they will go. But it's not the end of the world, guys. They're going to find a way around this. They're going to find a way to change things. I don't know exactly how it's all going to play out, of course, but I really did like this issue. I do have problems with it. I feel like emotionally they're trying to get us to a place that hasn't really been earned, because they haven't really put those building blocks there in the first place. But I like how diabolical Harth is. I like how responsible Buffy is. I like how noble Faith is. I like how worried Willow is. I like how in love Xander and Dawn are. And I like how Giles has this real sense of mourning. Because, I mean, his whole life he's been groomed to be a watcher and make sure that slayers live. And what he's being called to do is watch these girls die right now. And it's really hard for him. Again, I wish that this were Kid Giles, but whatever. I really enjoyed everything that's going on here. There's not a shit ton of Spike, but the moments with Spike, they really work. And again, like, I would say that this is the best issue of the season so far, and if it continues on this path, then hopefully this really will be a great ending for the Buffy Dark Horse comic books. Which segues into last week we found out that Dark Horse is losing the Buffy title. Does that mean that Buffy's going to be going to Marvel? I don't know. Does it mean that Buffy's going to be going over to Boom, like the Firefly comics did? I don't know. But I really have kind of come to terms with the fact that it's the end of Buffy, guys. Like, it's the end of the world as we know it.
Goodbye.
And I just love Buffy so much, and I, this issue, everything that Buffy does, everything that Faith does, it it makes me feel like we really are going to leave this in a good and satisfying place, even though, again, some of it hasn't really been earned. I'm happy to see them go out swinging. Like, swing for the fences, man. Like, maybe they won't hit it out of the park, but they'll give it a good go. They'll give it a good, you know, college try. And that's all I really want, because Buffy's all about the trying. Like, Buffy is all about, like, tomorrow you might be dead, so go out there and fucking try to live your life. And that's what this book is doing, and that's what Buffy the character is doing, and that's what I really respect about this particular issue. And, you know, I don't want Buffy to end. I think that Buffy should never, ever end, because Buffy never dies, and even when you kill her, this bitch comes back and you can't stop her.
Exactly.
But guys, that's pretty much all I've got for today. I hope you're having a great 2018 so far, everybody. You can come right back here to the Buffyngton Post anytime for Buffy the Vampire Slayer reviews, Angel and Faith reviews, Buffyverse discussions, discussions on the other Slayers. Tuz and I will be back with our re-recording of History Buff. We went through No Future for You, but we didn't realize that the other half of our video totally didn't get recorded, so we're going to have to re-record that. But yeah, stay tuned for that. And yeah, Planet Earth, please let me know what you thought of this issue in the comment section down below. Be sure to like, comment, share, subscribe, and as always, question. I'm Preston L. Young. Have yourself a great day today, and we'll see you next time. Bye.
When I was young, younger than before, I never saw the truth hanging from the door. And I will only see you face to face.